and it reads on this wise. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him and will sup with him, and he with me. Is that about how your Bible reads? That's how I read Revelation, the third chapter, verse number 20. May the Lord have a blessing to the hearer, to the reader, but above all to the doers of his written word. I want to preach by aid of the Holy Spirit for just a moment. A sermon entitled, God Don't Need You, But He Does Want You. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
It's important to know,
it's important to know
that God
don't need you,
but He wants you.
But he wants.
Look at your other neighbor and say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
You pray.
You pray.
And the pastor preach.
God,
God don't need you. My brothers and sisters, over a couple of thousand years ago, when the Apostle John was pulled from where he was to bear witness in a vision, to give God honor and praise, Jesus gave him a revelation. And the revelation was the revelation of Jesus. And he spoke to seven churches. And each one of those churches represent one of the churches, all of the churches today. But this was the last church that he spoke to. And this is known as the Church of Laodicea. And in this church, this seventh church, in this third chapter, he wanted the church to know that he knows thy works. Sometimes when we are doing what we're doing, we may think that God does not know what's going on. But God sees you no matter where you are. God sees us in the dark as well as in the light. God sees us in our cars when we ride down the road by ourselves, talking to ourselves. He sees our text messages. He hears our phone calls. He hears our chatter when we're out in the parking lot. He hears what we got to say when we go in the bathroom and have a little bathroom meeting. Y'all ain't want to say that. He wants us to understand that he knows our works. And he talks here and he lets the church know that I know that you're neither cold nor hot. He says, I realize that you are lukewarm. But it lets the church know that I wish that you were not, you were either cold or you're hot. But if you're lukewarm, I'll spew you out of my mouth. You gotta understand that back during that time there was a fountain, and if the water was hot that came forth, it was good. And if it was cold, it was good. But if it was lukewarm, it tasted nasty. And as soon as anybody tasted, they would spit it out of their mouth. You see, Laodiceans thought that they had it going on. And the reason they thought that they had it going on, because they made an assessment of themselves without looking at the assessment that God had of them. And I want to make it plain that if you assess yourself without the assessment of God, you are always going to be out of order. Have I got a witness in here? If you don't believe me, you can look back over in the Gospels and you will discover a man that was a Pharisee that went in, and the Bible says Jesus in red writing recorded that he prayed to himself. The prayers didn't even go up past the ceiling. In other words, the Lord wasn't trying to hear that. And he bragged on himself and talked about what he didn't do. Anybody can talk about what they don't do. And he talked about what he did. Likewise, anybody can talk about what you do. But then there was a publican that came in that wouldn't even look up towards heaven, but came in with a bowed head and a humbled heart, and he smote upon his chest and he said, "Lord, have mercy on me." And he said that man went out justified rather than the other. God knows your works. And he assessed the situation here, but he let them know that he knew what their thoughts were. They thought that because they were rich financially, they thought because they had increased in goods, and they thought that they had no need of anything, that they were just fine. And just because you, as our elders used to say, now have two nickels to rub together, just because you might be driving a little something that you like to drive, you living in a little something that you like to live in, if you don't have it with Jesus, you really don't have nothing at all. Because Jesus' assessment of them was different from them, because he says, truly, let me give you my assessment. You are rich, you are miserable, you're poor, you're blind, and you're even standing around naked. My brothers and sisters, verse 18 gives us the insight, and let me just break it down to you for the sake of time. Clearly, God does not need a group of folk like that. Clearly, God doesn't need a church that has an assessment of themselves like that. God doesn't need anybody that will live like that, that will act like that. What did they act like? They were wretched. In other words, they were unfortunate folk, and on the inside, they were unhappy. Anybody can fake the funk and look like you got it going on, but on the inside, you know you tore up from the floor. You're just as phony as a $2.56 bill. Hello, somebody. He said they were miserable. That means you're uncomfortable, and you're, in other words, you're pitiful. We don't hear that word too much anymore. He said they were poor, and poor is lacking and insufficient. It's not that the light's not there. It's just that your seeing is so dull till you can't see the forest for all these trees. He goes on, and not only does it say blind, but he says naked, which you're dealing with uncovered and unclothed. In other words, here you walking around thinking you got it going on, and really you're just shamefully naked and denying what is actually happening in your life. But I got some good news, though. Even though God doesn't need you, and let me make it plain, because God don't need me either. Hello, somebody. He got folks that can preach circles around me. Somebody say amen. You know, when Elijah thought he was the last one, you know, God let him know, I got 7,000 that never been a need of that. You didn't hear about the 7,000 only because Elijah did what he wanted him to do. If you do what God wants you to do, he'll go ahead and bless you real good. But even though God doesn't need us, he doesn't need me, he doesn't need you, the good news is he wants you. And I don't know about you, but I think it's better to be wanted than to be needed. Some folks walk around, and you used to see it especially in the workplace. They create work that nobody know where the key at, nobody know where the stuff at but them. And if they don't show up, it doesn't get done because they're trying to make themselves needful. You got folk that just want to look like they all that important on the workplace, but you're really not that important. You say, Reverend, how do you know? Die. Sunday. If the minister of music don't act right, somebody will play the organ next Sunday. If the usher don't show up, somebody will get on the usher next week. Can I get a witness in here? If the whole hymn choir walk out, somebody will lift the hymn, amen, next week. God don't need you. You don't need me. But I'm so glad that he wants you. But he don't want you to just come any kind of way. They got too many agendas now, Reverend Reed, that just want to have folk come any kind of way, and God just got to accept that. The devil is a liar. Hello, somebody. He wants them to realize something. He goes in that 18th verse and he gives instructions to the church of Laodicea, but he's also giving instructions to us. He says, buy tried gold that's been tried in the fire. What he wants us to realize is that if you try the gold that's been tried in the fire, you'll be rich because that blood of Jesus Christ is the gold that's been tried in the fire. Have we got a witness in here? He says, put on white raiment, which is the clothes of Jesus Christ, wherein you'll be clothed in righteousness. In other words, it's not about my way, it's not about your way, it's about the way that Jesus says is right. And if my way don't line up with what's right, and your way don't line up with what's right, as long as we decide that we're going to follow Jesus and his righteousness, we'll be all right. Have we got a witness in here? He says, anoint your eye with eye salve so that you'll be able to see. When you come and get connected with the Holy Ghost, something you couldn't see before, he'll open the blinded eyes and he'll allow you to be able to see. Have I got any witnesses in this place? He tells them, don't be lukewarm, and what he's talking about is repent. He tells you that he chastens those that he loves. He squashes out the mess in your life. He deflates you when you think you all of that. He allows you to be disciplined by the Holy Spirit of God. He rebukes with a sharp expression of disappointment, and he bids you to come and let him in. How do you know, Reverend? Because he says, I stand at the door and knock. Yeah. And you know, I thought about that thing. I thought about the one who came down from heaven. He was already in heaven, but he came down from heaven just to be able to knock at the door of our heart. He came and he walked on this earth for 33 long years. And 3 years of those were ministry. He came so that one day he'd be able to stand at the door of your heart and mine and knock. Am I right about it? You got to realize that not only did he do that, but he's got the right to stand at the door and knock because he died for your sins and for mine. You see, God don't need us, but he wants us. And that's why the Bible says that he stands at the door and knock. And when you look at the artist's rendition of the door, you will notice when Jesus stands there and knocks, even with all power in his hand, there's in a time of need won't force himself on you or me, but he stands there and he knocks on the door of our heart. He's got enough power to push the door down, because in the name of Jesus, every knee shall rise, every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Am I right about it? But with all that power, you say, Reverend, how do you know? Because when they came to get him in the Garden of Gethsemane, he asked the question, whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. He said, I am he. And the Bible says, they fell out. When they got up, after they fell out, they asked again, whom seek ye? They said, Jesus of Nazareth. And he said, I am he. And they fell out again. The one that just at the name of Jesus don't fall out. Don't think it's no coincidence. Because when he was down in the grave, when he got up on that Sunday morning, those guards standing around the tomb, they fell out. Am I right about it? Just like dead men. That same God comes and he knocks on our door, our stubborn door, our hard-hearted door, our door of ignorance, our door of unchanging. He still stands there and knocks. If we open the door, let him in. He will. I know he will. Come on in and sup with you. He don't need you, but he wants you. He's earned the right to knock at your door. He went to hell, back to heaven. He's got the right. He knocks. He's not gonna force his way. But if you open the door, he will. He will. I know he will. One day, he opened me up and told me, if you let me, I'll come in. I'll help you to open blind eyes. I'll help you to unstop deaf ears. I'll help you. But through the ministry, I want you to do. That's why, for the last 17 years, I've been jumping, I've been running, going, telling it on the mountain, everywhere I go, that same Jesus still knocking at other door, laying it.
Jesus.
You gotta have in your mind that, oh, How I love Jesus. You gotta have it in your heart. Oh, how I love Jesus. Am I right about it? See, because can't nobody else do what he can do for you. But with all the power he's got, he stands and he knocks. No doorknob on the outside. You gotta open up your heart and you have to accept it. And if you do it, you'll be blessed going in, and you'll be blessed going out. No matter what you need, he'll provide it. How do you know? Because the songwriter said, great is thy faithfulness. It was so good to have to say it again, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All that I have needed, thy hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness. And then he makes it personal, Lord, unto me. Let us stand to our feet as the hymn choir gets ready. Remember,